Okay, I think it switched you.
Now we're recording. So this file will drop on my computer and then I will drop it to you, Lindy, so you have a copy.
Okay.
Whenever you talk, your face will come up on the screen. So when you ask questions, if there's a noise that you make while she's talking, your face will then pop up. So sometimes when reporters interview on Zoom, they click mute so that any dog barking or any bump or anything on their side doesn't mess up the soundbite.
Oh, okay. Okay. That's a good idea.
And I just turn off my video and then mute myself because I don't want to ever interrupt it.
Well, cool. Okay. I'll do that. And this will be short and sweet. Here's what I'm going to have you do first, Leah, just so I have it on tape. Can you say and spell first and last name for me?
Sure. Leah Madara. L-E-A-H-M-A-D-A-R-A.
What's your exact title?
Program manager for the Women's Health Boutique.
And so it's called the Women's Health Boutique?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Although many of our patients are men.
Leah, let me have you tilt your camera down just a little bit. You've got quite a bit of headroom. If you tilt your... Yeah, okay. Now you're good. Now I'm gone.
Bye. Perfect. So is the boutique separate from a gift shop, or is that all the same thing?
Completely separate. The boutique is actually a Joint Commission accredited durable medical equipment supplier, which is a whole lot. So we just call ourselves the boutique. But we do have some gifty items that kind of pertain to the different service lines that we support, but we're not really gifty at all. Most of the products that we provide to patients, we file to insurance.
So let's talk about wigs. What do you offer with that?
So we carry full wigs, synthetic wigs. We carry head coverings. We carry partial wigs called halos that are open on the top and then have the hair kind of stitched around a band so that ladies can put a hat or a scarf or a kerchief over that. Often with chemo, there are hot flashes. And so sometimes a full wig is just a little too much for patients. So we do wig fittings. We have, like I said, the halos. We have bangs that are stitched on a headband as well. They kind of act in the same way as the halos. And then all of the different head covering options.
And I'm sure you've been able, you know, to witness over the years what it means to someone to be able to get something like that when they're going through traumatic hair loss like that. What's it been like for you to see, and what do you see?
It's been incredibly rewarding. I mean, we also carry mastectomy items at the boutique, and we often see patients for both of those items during their journey. And we find that women have a harder time losing their hair sometimes than a breast, because, you know, you can camouflage so much with clothes, and our hair is just such a visible part of who we are as women, especially. And so, you know, wig fittings are often very emotional. There are sometimes a lot of tears shed, but sometimes they can kind of be joyful and fun as well. If, you know, people bring their entourage with them, and, you know, we try things on, and I joke that we should have champagne as well and make it just a whole party, but it really is a meaningful experience. You know, people are at a very vulnerable place when they're going through chemo, and often, of course, they feel terrible. And then added to that is the trauma and stress of losing their hair. So we are fortunate that folks trust us enough to come to our boutique, and we have these great private fitting rooms and certified fitters, and we spend as much time as they need, and we just work with them and help them figure out what's going to be the right next step for them. Now, we don't carry human hair wigs for a variety of reasons. Again, when you feel yucky, the last thing you want to do is have to really fool with your hair. And so synthetic wigs are super duper simple. You just wash them and pop them right back on the stand, and they dry in the style that they came with. So there's no maintenance whatsoever. Human hair wigs are hair. So, you know, there's a lot to be done with them. And of course the cost is so much more prohibitive with the human hair wig. They're easily 3 to 4 times the cost of a synthetic. And so for ladies who especially are going through treatments, it's a short-term need that they have, 12 to 18 months. And so we want to find the right item for them in that particular piece of their journey.
One thing I found interesting with myself is that when I was first diagnosed, I was like, I don't care what I have to do, lose my hair, colostomy bag, anything. I don't care. I just want to live. Sure. And then you start going through it, and you get to the point where you start losing your hair, and you think you'll never care, but you do. Have you noticed that with people?
Absolutely. I have women that, you know, like I said, we see them early on in the diagnosis and they say, oh, I'm not going to wear a wig. I'm just going to rock the bald look. And that's great. And we have women who do that and it's amazing, but you know, it's such a personal choice. And I think it's also very situation dependent. So if you have a woman who's trying to go into work every single day, we've had a lot of educators that maybe teach elementary school. That's a tough conversation to keep having with third and fourth graders. Mrs. So-and-so, why do you look so different? Why, you know what I mean? So those are the ladies that are like, all right, I'll do the wig and I think I'm going to wear it. And then, you know, COVID certainly changed that a bit because we all stayed at home a little bit more than we would have normally. But I even have patients who have small kids at home and they find that it's just too upsetting to them and their kids for the kids to see them without a wig. And so they wear the wig from the minute they get dressed in the morning until they're ready for bed at night. It's totally a personal choice.
Yeah, that never occurred to me. Do you get requests for human hair wigs? And if so, what do you guys do about that?
Occasionally, and there are some other great shops in the greater Indianapolis area. You know, we're so fortunate to have a lot of resources within a 45-mile radius. So there are some shops that really are true wig specialty shops. That's their whole deal. And so they do have human hair wigs. And our vendors that we've worked with for years also make human wigs. So we've had alopecia patients in the past who, you know, the need is ongoing. And so we have ordered human hair for wigs for them in the past. It's just not something that we do more than, you know, once or twice every couple of years. But again, the human hair wigs last that long. So a synthetic wig, its lifespan, if you will, depending on where, obviously, is about a year. Human hair wigs will last 3 to 4 years.
Now, I was actually denied wig coverage with insurance. What is the insurance deal like with people?
You know, I have a lot I could say about that, a lot of opinions on that.
Just whatever you're comfortable with.
It's one of those things, unfortunately, and really when we're looking at the grand scheme of the total cost of cancer treatment, a wig is such a tiny, tiny piece. I mean, we're talking less than $500. And so for insurance companies to not cover, I think is absolutely ridiculous, but unfortunately it's the reality. I would say that within commercial payers, there are probably, 50% of commercial payer plans who cover wigs and 50% that just right off the bat say it's an excluded item. And it's confusing for patients because their oncologist will write a prescription because it's a cranial prosthesis. I mean, we all call them wigs, of course, but when you think that a prosthesis is replacing something that's missing, it's a cranial prosthesis. And so the doctor has ordered it. They've got this script. They certainly have this need. And then when it's denied by their insurance provider, it's really frustrating for them. So we work with patients. We offer self-pay discounts because unfortunately, that is the reality that a lot of our patients are faced with, is that it's an out-of-pocket cost. With a prescription, certainly that they can file it to their HSA and FSA. And so we try to help facilitate that with them as well.
That's so true. I was so confused because I had a prescription.
Absolutely.
It was just crazy. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about you're seeing more than just people with chemo who are needing the wigs. What's going on?
So, you know, we really, for a while when COVID, first started and so many outpatient services were shut down, we couldn't even offer wig fittings for a while. So then when we reopened, at first it seemed like, okay, the floodgates have just opened back up and we're seeing this backlog of patients who we weren't able to help while we were closed. And then we realized that we were seeing a lot more patients who were not coming to us with a need because they're going through chemo, but because they've had COVID. And so COVID has caused some long-term thinning or hair loss. And, you know, thinning, depending on the amount of hair that you have to begin with, maybe it's an issue, maybe it's not. So for women especially, you know, there are so many things that cause female hair loss, medications, hormone issues, and then stress, certainly, like we talked about. And with COVID, I think that just exacerbated some of the conditions that ladies were already dealing with. So we really have had quite a few patients over the last 12 months who seek us out because they're like, I don't know if my hair is going to eventually grow back in, but right now I very much need a wig.
So can anyone come to you for help?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. We do request appointments just because, you know, we want a certified fitter available to work with ladies and we don't want anybody to feel rushed. And so we do request appointments, but yeah, we're happy to help anyone at any stage.
Wow, that is so cool. What about people who are watching who, you know, may want to like help in some way? What can people do if they want to help the boutique?
You know, we really are not, in terms of like hair donation, that's not typically something that we play a role in for a whole host of reasons. There are some really fabulous organizations though that have a whole process in place for hair donation. Locks of Love is one that so many folks are familiar with. Revlon has their own hair donation program if you get on their website. There are a lot of regulations that they put in place about like whether hair is allowed to be color treated, the length of the hair, how it needs to arrive to them. So we always encourage folks, because that is a question we commonly get from people that stop in with this, you know, fabulous Disney princess hair that, you know, is down to their mid belly. And they're like, how do I donate this? Can we just hand this to you? And so we encourage them to seek out those other organizations because they have a great system in place.
What about monetary donations? Does that help you at all with being able to help people with wigs or?
The St. Vincent Foundation has, or Ascension St. Vincent Foundation has some really phenomenal programs in place. And so we always encourage patients or loved ones to start there because they're going to have all of the connections to make the best use of those gifts, certainly.
Finally, just overall, like you were saying, if people want to donate their hair or whatever,
Yeah, it's pretty easy. I mean, most of that starts in a salon because obviously, you know, I mean, for the very brave folks, they might want to take scissors at home and just cut above the ponytail. I'm not that brave. But, you know, most of that starts in a salon and a lot of stylists are familiar with that process. And so they can kind of help facilitate the next steps for patients who or for ladies who want to do that.
So tell me again how long you've worked there.
It'll be 15 years this fall.
Why'd you get into that?
You know, I have a degree in not-for-profit management. And so I was looking for a new opportunity, what seems like 100 years ago now in 2007. And there was this new boutique that was opening at the St. Vincent Carmel Hospital. And I didn't even know where the hospital was. So before my interview, I drove here to make sure I knew what I was doing. And it was a whole new venture. So we had a boutique at 86th Street and they were like, we're going to duplicate this for Carmel. And I thought, I've got management experience. I like people. I can work in a hospital. And 15 years later, here I am. It's a real gift. I think I shared with you, you know, this feels like my first baby because I have seen the boutique grow from a 400 square foot space to 1900 square feet. And we have, again, gone through the Joint Commission accreditation process, which is a huge undertaking. We really getting to hear those stories from patients every day about how they feel like a woman again when they leave our space. It's amazing. It just doesn't get better than that.
Do you feel like a lot of people donate blood and think of that, but people don't necessarily think of other things?
Absolutely. And I think, you know, unfortunately, so many of us have had our lives touched by cancer in some way, whether it's a personal diagnosis or a family member or a loved one. But, you know, I also think that, and blood donations are great. Please go donate blood. I mean, obviously, that's something that we very much need. But I just don't think sometimes people are in tune with how important some of those things are until they've either walked it or walked alongside someone who has gone through it. To see the distress that it causes to lose your hair, to go through a mastectomy. Because like you said, initially upon diagnosis, your goal is just like, I'm going to beat this and I'm going to be here and everything else is secondary. And yes, big picture it is, but that doesn't minimize the distress of going through all of those stages.
Well, I have you. I thought you had said something about you're having a shortage of something, some other stuff because of COVID. What was that?
So, we've definitely had supply chain interruptions with everything. We carry, like I said, mastectomy items, maternity items, breast pumps, bariatric supplements for our post-surgical patients. And so it's really been kind of a rolling what's on back order this week. You know, with wigs, it has changed how we do the fittings. Typically, we would just do the fitting. The patient selects the color they want. We just say, hey, we'll drop ship it to your house. It'll be there in 7 days. Well, now we call the manufacturer and say, do you have this in stock? If not, when is it coming back in? If that timeline doesn't work for the patient's needs, then we pivot and say, okay, can't get this color, but we can get these three colors. What do you like instead? So it's definitely changed that type of thing.
And that's still happening?
It's still happening. And like I said, it's every week it's a different product or a different item. I was sharing with Brenna that, you know, it's like one week we call and it seems like we can't get any blonde hybrid highlights. And then it's like the next week we can't find brunettes, you know? So it just seems like it's really just the whole supply chain interruption that we continue to experience and every industry is experiencing.
Yeah. When I talked to my RN navigator a few weeks ago, you were out of blonde at the time. She told me about that. Also, just real quick, tell me a little bit about your family, how many kids you have and stuff and where you live.
My husband and I live in McCordsville and we have two children. I have a 5-year-old and a 3.5-year-old. So we have two boys. They are 17 months apart. They are highly active, super busy and pretty strong-willed.
You're in McCordsville. Wow.
McCordsville.
What do people need to know about the boutique, like hours wise and stuff?
The boutique is open Monday through Friday, 8:30 to 4:30. We are staffed by certified fitters. And actually just kind of a point that I think is interesting. 3 of our fitters are cancer survivors themselves. And so obviously we've got some amazing fitters who have not walked that walk and have not been through that journey, but to have a lady in a fitting room, and especially when we have someone that's like, you know, they're just diagnosed, they're terrified. And I have a fitter that's like, you know, I was diagnosed 17 years ago and I did this, and here I am. I think that's just such an amazing gift that we can offer. We're located inside the Ascension St. Vincent Carmel Women's Center, and we're just inside of entrance 3. Folks can call us with any questions. We're happy to talk through anything with them. It's a very warm and inviting environment, private fitting rooms. Thankfully now we're able to have visitors come along. So, you know, we're able to have 2 visitors with each patient. So if folks wanted to schedule a fitting and they want to bring loved ones, that's a possibility again, which is nice.
Are the fitters, do you take volunteers or are these actual jobs?
These are certified fitters. So it's actually a national credentialing process that 500 hours of fitting experience. And then you sit for a certification exam through the accrediting body. And then you have to do CEUs every year to maintain that accreditation.
Wow. I did not know.
So I didn't know it when I came in here. It's one of those things that, you know, you don't think about all of it because like we do compression fittings as well. And so none of us have a medical background per se. I do have one fitter who was a respiratory therapist early in her career, but you know, most of us came into it without any durable medical experience. And because a lot of durable medical experience really pertains to like oxygen and hospital beds and wheelchairs, and we're a very different side of DME. And so, you know, as I look for new candidates when we have open positions, I know I'm not ever going to find a candidate that's like, yeah, I'm a certified mastectomy fitter and I also do compression. And those are all skill sets that we train and, you know, we foster that development here.
Have you happened to donate hair yourself?
I wish I could. My hair won't get longer than this. My son, my 3-year-old, the other day, we were watching Moana. And you know, Moana's mom has this long hair that's like braided and gorgeous. He goes, look at Moana's mommy. She's so beautiful. I said, oh, she is so beautiful, bud. He goes, I wish you looked like that.
Stop.
Oh, I was like, thanks, pal. Me too. I really wish I looked like that as well. Daddy probably does as well, but I'm really sorry.
That's this is hilarious. What we got. I was here, Daddy, why is mom coughing all the time? Why is mom sick all the time? I'm like, because I'm down half a lung.
Oh.
Is there anything else you want to add that I didn't ask? Anything that's important people know?
I don't think so. I'm just excited for the opportunity for more people to hear about the boutique.
We covered some great stuff. I really like this. I'm wondering about pictures and video of the boutique now. Do you guys
have? I was telling Brenna, we moved into our current space in 2015 and we did have a professional photographer come at the time. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, obviously the pictures are a bit outdated, but they kind of give you the main idea. I'm going to look for those. And I'm also going to try to snap a few pictures with my phone and send them over. But I mean, if those don't seem like the right fit, because I'm not a photographer, I'll put that out there. You know, feel free to send someone anytime. Well,
that's what I was going to see, if maybe I could get BJ or one of our photographers to maybe come out Monday morning and just shoot some video for it.
Oh, sure.
Okay, let me see if I can do that.
Okay, that'd be great.
Yeah. Yeah, plus I'd like to come myself.
Yeah, I'd love that. I think it's so helpful for patients to see that too, because, you know, you just don't ever, so people walk past us and they do think we're a gift shop because it does look inviting and warm. And we have pretty nursing covers and nursing bras and, you know, that kind of stuff. So, I mean, we try to have some things that make it feel warm and inviting, and our fitting rooms are decorated nicely. And, you know, we hear from ladies that their very first experience getting a prosthesis or compression was like in a supply closet somewhere. And I'm like, no, that's not how we do things here. So we want people to see that it's not an intimidating space. There's no pressure. It's super inviting and warm, and folks can just walk in and browse around and ask questions. That's what we're here for.
Oh, and just because I'm curious, so men get wigs too, huh?
Not wigs. We have men who are compression patients. I will say, in 15 years, I have sold 2 wigs to men. And so those were interesting experiences, because that's just not the norm.
Yeah.
But we do see a lot of men for compression stockings, different compression garments. We see men for the bariatric supplements. I mean, easily 50% of our patient population there is male. But yeah, it's always interesting, because when you come to the boutique, you'll see that we have sort of subdivided sections. So we have like maternity stuff here, and we have kind of wigs displayed on a certain wall. But inevitably men walk past something that they just didn't know existed, like pelvic floor products. And they're like,
Exactly. I can picture it.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Well, this is going to air Thursday. It's one of our sweeps pieces, so it'll probably be a different show, but I need to find out like exactly what time and all that.
Sure, thank you.
I'm so grateful that you did this.
Oh, I know. Thank you so much.
I'm really excited, and, you know, just it's especially close to my heart, obviously, as well, you know, helping people in these situations. Sorry, I look like this. I'm in between. I did the morning show, and then I have 3 more shoots today. And
oh my goodness, please don't apologize at all. Right. You look great.
Oh, thanks. Thanks. All right. If you think of anything else, feel free to contact me, because I can at least say it myself. It doesn't have to be a soundbite from you.
Yeah.
And my web version can be a lot longer, so, you know, I can include more there. And we'll do links to, is there a website?
I'm going to send you those links, because we have a website that kind of explains what the boutique is. And then we have a website that has kind of an online listing of the products. It doesn't go into depth about wigs as much, because you need to make an appointment for that. But for instance, you can look at the halo wigs and some of the wig accessories online as well.
I didn't know you could only get bangs.
Yeah. So they're like kind of attached to it. And the bangs are attached. And so what we hear a lot from ladies is that when they have lost all their hair and they put a cap on, they feel like they're wearing a sign that says, I'm sick, I'm sick, I'm sick, everywhere they go. And so with a little bit of a halo, then, you know, you've got a little bit of hair coming down and you just have like your cute little kerchief or scarf or baseball hat. And, you know, for all anybody else knows, you just have your hair twisted up underneath and nobody knows. So those are things that people will get, like, you know, for running errands on the weekend or kids' soccer games.
Do you have any clue how many women come in for wigs a week or a day? Or
last week we had 8 wig fittings, and I was like, did marketing put up a billboard that I was unaware of? Which I'm like, great, thank you. I love that. it really varies, honestly. Okay. You know, with again, with COVID, we are seeing delayed diagnosis with cancer patients. And so it seems like we have like a spurt of patients that maybe have started treatment around the same time. Mm-hmm. So it just kind of goes in ebbs and flows.
Would you say nearly daily someone comes in for a wig?
Yeah, or head covering, if it's not a wig, because, you know, certainly wigs are great and wonderful, but also like when you're sitting in a 6-hour infusion, who wants to wear a wig? You want like a comfy cap that keeps your head warm, because that's a thing that people don't think about. It really goes beyond just the appearance and the fashion to the function of, oh, my head is really cold, because our hair serves a purpose there. And so we have caps that ladies sleep in that are just like really soft kind of toboggan-y type caps that don't have really dominant seams that you're not laying on. And, you know, and then we have caps that ladies just want to throw on to go out for a walk or to go walk the dog or to run to Starbucks. So it's nice to have an assortment. It is cold.
I lost like 80 or 90% of mine. And mine was mainly from malnutrition, not so much the chemo regimen I was on, but I mean, it was just, yeah.
Hard to believe now, Lindy, your hair looks like.
I know, your hair is so thick and fabulous.
I'm fortunate it's coming back like it was. I hear for a lot of people, it can come back in totally different.
It does. So a lot of times we get patients who had just poker straight hair to begin with, and then it grows back with texture. And so then all of a sudden they're like, what do I do with all these curls?
Yeah, or different colors even, I've heard.
Different colors. That's always the shocker, you know, because most of us color our hair, right? So then when it comes back in, you're like, where are my highlights?
Yeah.
I need those.
Yeah. Well, awesome. Thank you both so much.
Thank you.
I'll post it on when this will air, and I'll also let you know about Monday.
Okay, great. I'll say what I have here and like what I can snap and send over. But obviously, if you could send someone, that'd be amazing.
Yeah. Awesome. Brenna, thank you so much for setting us up and everything.
I'm glad we got to meet. Sorry, I'm not Danielle, but I'm glad I picked up the phone.
No, that's what we are. Well, when I saw the last email she had sent was last like August, I thought, I wonder if she's still there.
She moved on. Yep. All right. And then I'll send you an email, Lindy, with Leah's contact information. And we all do the same for you. But also those links to the websites, the address of the boutique, and then, of course, the link to this video.
Oh, and can Great. People reserve a time to come in online, or do they need to call?
They need to call, because we usually have questions that we like to talk through about like where they're at in the treatment process. Okay. And, you know, we have them bring a prescription if they have one, and we give them billing codes so that they can check insurance benefits and all that stuff.
Sorry to have one more question. If someone's a cancer patient at community, they can still come?
Oh, 100%. Okay. Absolutely. We see people, like I said, really from all over the state.
Okay. Because I'm sure people would ask me that. So. All righty. Sounds good. Thank you both so much.
Thank you very much.
Enjoy your morning.
You too. Bye. Bye-bye.